Hey guys, so today we're gonna do lesson number one for beginners. So this is like typically what you would kind of go over with me if you were to come to a lesson, but I know that it's expensive and a lot of people wanna get a little bit ahead before they come to a lesson, and that's fine, or they just wanna see what lessons are like. So the first thing that we're going to do is talk about tuning really quickly. So you might as well go ahead and get one of these. I love this. You've seen me use this before. And it's very easy. So we're going to do, I wish I could put this up somewhere, but basically I will play my string and you'll see here that the lights will go back and forth. And you're going to want to get it on this green, okay? And you see this little symbol here? If it'll focus. This is a flat. So when something is flat, it's too low. So if it's on the flat side, you need to raise it higher because it's too low. And then this one over here, this is the hashtag symbol that we all know so well. This is a sharp. So if it's sharp, then it's too high and you need to lower it a little bit. So you'll see, you'll get the flow. So what I'm gonna do here is just check my strings are in tune and then we'll get started, okay? I did have a video on how to tune that was really old and I didn't realize that the camera had switched me, so it looked like I was playing like this way and it was very confusing. So thank you guys for pointing that out. If you did point that out, I appreciate it. So anyway, what we're going to do is grab the A string. Now this is a viola, so my A string is the top string. So I have A, D, G, and C. If you're on the violin, we're going to share 3 out of 4 strings. So you're going to have an E string, which is higher, and then we're going to have the A string, D string, and G string. So we'll have those 3 strings together. So anyway, we're going to start regardless with the A string. Teeny bit sharp. So by the way, also you can change the frequency. So you'll see in the corner over here. So if you change the calib, you see how these numbers go up and down over here. So I have mine set on 441. It's just kind of like a standard tuning for strings for orchestra. 441, 442, depending on where you go. So there's the A, and I'm using a fine tuner here because it's very precise. If I was going to be tuning something that was really out, so if I was trying to tune to an A, but I was at a G, which is one note below, I would use my peg. So since that's close, I don't need to. When I tune, I'm trying to get a nice clear sound out. I know that can be difficult when you're a beginner, but you want to avoid doing this because it's just hard for the tuner to hear that. So there we go, that is tuning. So now what we're gonna do is talk about our bow hand really quickly. So I do have a video specifically on this. There's many videos, so if you want something more in-depth, take a look at those. But this is basically what it's going to look like, okay? So you see how the pinky here is our balancing finger. It's curved, so it's not like this, because this is unstable here. The fourth finger is kind of wrapped around this little eye here. The middle finger and thumb are creating a circle. The thumb is probably gonna have a tendency to do this when you're holding the bow. You see how my thumb is curved in this way? But see, this is also quite unstable, so you want to have this circle. So if you can keep that in mind, that would be good. And then we're going to put the first finger leaning up like this. So not leaning down, but leaning up, okay? And you'll see how my elbow kind of changes level for that. So you might experiment with that when you have the instrument up. Okay, so I do have a video on setup, all about setup. A lot of people are curious about these little scarves here, this is just like a square scarf. I fold it over and then I secure it with a rubber band. And it's just kind of nice. It's more comfortable. And I don't know, I like them. So that's how I secure it. I have a coon shoulder rest. I did have a different one for ages, but we broke up, me and that shoulder rest. So I now use a coon. There's many different chin rests out there. This one in particular is called a Whitner hypoallergenic chin rest. And it does go over the tailpiece a little bit, so you see how it's sitting over here. And that's just because a lot of times our chin does naturally go over the tailpiece. It doesn't really matter that it's hypoallergenic because I cover it anyway with a scarf, but if you're sensitive to metal, I have very sensitive skin, so I guess that's what initially drew me to that. But anyway, there's many different chin rests and you should definitely try out a lot and see what's more comfortable. But you're gonna want your instrument to be sitting up like this. So you see how my scroll and my eyes are kind of eye level, so it's not drooping down like that. That's kind of what you want. And you also want it to be really comfortable. And you see how my body is not really changing at all. So I'm not doing this to hold the instrument or this to hold the instrument. My spine is straight and I'm just lowering my head. And that's because you are going to be playing in this position for a long time and you should make sure that your posture is correct, because otherwise you may injure yourself and you will be making your body move less efficiently. So we want to move efficiently and comfortably and in the most natural way. So just, you got to have your posture correct. Okay, so that's our basic setup. So now what we're going to do is we're going to talk about sound, because that is the first thing that we would go over in your lesson. We're going to do some bowing exercises, and then I'm going to give you some intervals to learn so that you can start to hear things by ear. And it's going to help your sense of pitch as well. So, and then we'll kind of call it a day. I might give you an assignment, we'll see. Okay, so the first exercise is called triangle square extend, and I have talked about this before in previous videos, but what you're going to do, first of all, we're gonna put the bow on the string. Doesn't really matter what string. I kind of like to stick to the second from the top string. It's just kind of easier. This is a really harsh angle. This is just a little bit more comfortable, so that's why I'm choosing that one. And I'm gonna put my bow at the frog. This area is called the frog. And you can see how my arm is just, if I would raise it, this is what my arm does. So my elbow is below, my wrist is curved, my fingers are relaxed. Everything's kind of hanging from here. So make sure that you don't do something like this when you put the bow up, because you're locking your arm this way. Remember, we talked about posture before and how we want to use our body efficiently. Is this an efficient way to move? Probably not. This is a little bit easier. It requires less work and it's more relaxed. So let's see if we can maintain that. So pop that at the frog. Okay, now we're going to do this exercise, which may not work with my setup very well, but so you see there's a triangle here, and you see how my bow is parallel to the bridge and parallel to the fingerboard here. So we're gonna make sure that that is correct, and then we're going to move to a square. So until my arm extends to a square. Okay, so just like this. Okay, now I have to figure out how to move you so that you can actually see what I'm doing. Maybe that's a little bit better. Maybe not. We'll just work with it, okay? So, triangle. Square. Bow is still parallel, okay? And then we're going to extend it from the elbow here all the way out. And the entire time the shoulder is nice and relaxed, the arm is hanging on the string. Everything is comfortable, okay? And also remember to breathe, so. So you're gonna do this exercise probably for a couple minutes, and if you can do it in front of a mirror, that would be good. That might confuse you at first, because there is a lot of things to just kind of focus on at the beginning. So try that exercise out on a couple strings or on all of the strings. And remember, when you change strings, you need to raise your shoulder, because otherwise you're gonna look like this when you're on the lowest string. And this one, you know, you don't have any weight. So when you have the correct angle of everything, then you're gonna have a nice sound. All right. So once you're comfortable with that, there is one other exercise that you could do. So this is just my string crossing exercise that I like, that I personally really like. So you can do this with a metronome if you want. So let's grab this again and we'll turn it on to 72 and the beat is on zero. So there's just no accent, you know, like if we had this on two, you'd have a strong sound on one, a click on two, and then a strong accent on one, etc. So if you had it on three, the same thing would happen. So let me put this on in the background. Hopefully it's not too annoying. We're going to do four beats per bow. So four clicks in a bow. So should we use like the entire bow in one beat and then save it for three at the end? Probably not. So let's see if we can divide the bow in quarters, okay? So a good rule of thumb would just be to just kind of try to feel where the middle of the bow is. And we're going to do four beats per bow and four bows on each string. And then you're gonna change to the next string, same thing. And then fall to the next string, and then same thing, okay? And we're starting at the bottom, so the lowest string, and going to the top string. Because it's gonna feel different if we go vice versa, which you can do. It's just going to, your arm is gonna be moving differently. You're gonna be lifting rather than falling, okay? So that's the first part of the string crossing exercise. So funny, I'm always cooking in these videos. I have some soup on the stove. Let me just go check that. I'll be right back. Okay, got the soup. I'm making lentil soup. It's so good. I wish I could give you some. excuse me. So the next exercise in the string crossing exercise is to do two consecutive strings back and forth. And you're still going to have your metronome on 72. But I guess we don't really need it for this lesson because I'm just kind of demonstrating. But, so same thing, four beats per bow. And you're just gonna go back and forth between two consecutive strings. So for example, it would look like this. That wasn't very good, let me try that again. To the middle two strings and then the top two strings. And again, we're going from the bottom string to the upper string. Okay? And you're going to leave the bow on the string the entire time. So I'm not lifting it. I don't know if you can see that very well. But if I lifted it, it would look like this. That's just not how you're going to be playing most of the time. Most of the time you're going to be changing strings with the bow on the string so that you can sustain the sound. Now the next one, the third one, is crossing a string. So we would be going from the bottom string to the, we're going to skip over the middle string here and go to this one. So on the viola, I'm going from the C string to the D string. If you're in the violin, this would be the G string to the A string. Okay, so same thing, and then you would go from the D string if you're on the violin to the E string. So same thing, four beats per bow. Two, three, four, and back and forth a few times. Okay, almost done. The next one is the outer strings, so from the out the bottom string to the very top string. Same thing, leave the bow on the string. fourth. And then finally, we have all the strings in one bow. So if we have our metronome on, you're going to have one click for each string. Just, you know, you can keep that going for a little while. All right. Now with this exercise, we did this using the entire bow. And that might be a little bit challenging. So if you want, you can divide the bow in half and just work in the lower half. Or you could work in the upper half. Now let me just demonstrate, or you could just work in the middle too. You can just choose to work in the middle, like 5 inches of bow. But let me just show you. When you're working in the lower half of the bow, everything's gonna happen really quickly because the distances between the strings is quite small. And that might not make sense right now, but it will when I show you the upper half. So I'm just moving pretty small distance here. If you look at my elbow. Now if I, I'm gonna try not to knock my water over. If we are in the upper half of the bow, it's a little bit different story. So let's say we're kind of here. Now look how far I have to move. It's a huge distance in comparison to this, right? So you're gonna feel like things happen very quickly here and that you really have to move a lot here. Both places though, you're gonna be moving from here first. Lifting, raising, lifting, raising, okay? Because that's, you know, just the biggest joint there, so just move that and everything else will follow. So that is our exercises. So you're going to be doing the triangle square extend exercise to make sure that you're staying parallel to the bridge and fingerboard and that your bow is staying in one place, so it's not kind of going all over the place. And it's also going to help you to understand how the kind of bow mechanics work. So just kind of watch yourself and remember in a mirror, and remember that you're going to be holding your arm like this, because this is the natural way that we would raise our arm. We wouldn't raise our arm like this normally, right? You have to work to do that. So just think how you would normally move your body, what's the easiest way to move your body, and that will probably be the correct way. excuse me, I'm getting over a cold. So then we talked about string crossings. So just to recap, if you do this with a metronome, it's going to keep your bow speed really consistent because you're trying to fit 4 beats in a bow. You can do this without the metronome, but just try to stick with a steady bow speed and keep everything really controlled. So the first exercise is just 4 bows at least, 1, 2, 3, 4 bows on each string, starting on the bottom string and going to the upper string. Or you can go from the upper string down to the bottom string, but just remember that your arm will move differently that way. Okay? And then the next one is consecutive string crossing, so back and forth between 2 consecutive strings, the bottom 2, middle 2, upper 2. And then we're going to skip a string, so that's the third exercise, so from the bottom string to the second to the top string, so like G to A. And then D to E if you're on the violin. Now there's 2 more, so the almost second to last one is the outer strings. So from the bottom string to the top string, you're gonna leave the bow on the entire time. Don't lift it off the string. And then finally we have all the strings in one bow. Okay, back and forth. And that's it. So you can practice that for maybe, I mean, you could practice that for 15 to 30 minutes or more, but it's better to kind of do things in short bursts because our mind remembers things a little bit better that way and we can focus more. So before you go, before you click away, let me teach you an interval, 2 intervals actually. Now an interval is just the distance between 2 notes. So here's 1 note, here's another note. This is quite a small interval. What about this one to this one? This one's a little bit bigger. So this one's gonna sound like da, da. And this one might sound like da, da. So they're a little bit closer together. Now to learn the intervals, we're gonna be using a song, 2 songs, because we have 2 intervals. So the first one we're going to learn is called a half step, which is also known as a minor second. I'm going to bring you a little closer so that you can look at my left hand. Okay, now a half step on the violin or on the viola always looks like this. So two and three here. And you see how they are squished together. Okay, so you could also play a half step like this or like this. So all the way at the end here with the open string. Open and then a low one. You could also do 3-4 or 3-4, you know, in different positions. Excuse me. But I need a little drink. But all you really have to remember is that a half step is fingers together. Fingers together. And it sounds like Jaws. That scary movie. Or. Okay? So it always sounds like Jaws. Doesn't matter if it's up here. Or down here. It's a half step. It's always gonna sound like a half step, which sounds like Jaws. Now the next one is a whole step, which is also known as a major second. So a whole step is very similar to a half step. It's two consecutive fingers, but there's a gap in between them. So this is a half step, two consecutive fingers squished together, and a whole step. This is consecutive fingers, but squished apart. I'm sorry, spread apart. Spread apart, okay? So that always sounds like do, re, mi. If you're going up, do, re, mi. Climbing the stairs, do, re, mi. Or if you're coming down the stairs, three blind mice, three blind mice. Okay, so let me play you do, re, mi. And this is an easy way to play it if you wanted to know. It's just open, one, two. So we have a space between the open string and first finger. And then a space between first finger and second finger. Okay? And it sounds like do, re, mi. So if I played, you would hear that that was completely wrong, right? Because we're listening for do, re, mi. Do, re, mi. Let me play you some minor seconds and major seconds, half steps and whole steps, and see if you can tell what they are. So I'm gonna move my left hand away so you can't see. You're just gonna have to listen, okay? So what is this one? That one's a half step or a minor second. They're the same thing. What about this one? Also a minor second or a half step, yep. And what about this one? That's do, re, mi. Okay. What about this one? This is three blind mice. So it's also a whole step or a major second, okay? So what you should do with this is practice. If you already know how to play a little bit, you could practice playing these. If you want to look at a video that might help you figure out the left hand, we are gonna go over that in the next video, but if you want a video now, take a look at my basic hand pattern video, and that will kind of outline where your fingers go. That's just the first hand pattern that you're gonna learn typically on the violin, because it's just easier. It's more, I think the word is ergonomic, is that right? Anyway, so if you don't know how to play these though, then practice singing them. And remember, a half step is fingers together, da-dum, da-dum. And a whole step is fingers apart. Do, re, mi, do, re, mi, okay? So that is it. I hope that you enjoyed your first lesson. Next lesson, we are going to probably go over, we'll talk a little bit about the basic hand pattern. So we will maybe talk about reading notes, and we'll look at Suzuki book number one. Okay? So, and we'll learn two more intervals. So I'll see you for the next lesson, and happy practicing, you guys. See you soon.